Hi, this video covers while loops. So first, let's talk about code repeating. Why might we want to create code that's going to repeat multiple times? Well, think about when there's times we want to do things many, many times, and we want it to be really efficient. So one idea comes to mind is the song 99 bottles of root beer on the wall, or we've changed it to tea, 99 bottles of tea on the wall, 99 bottles of tea, take one down and pass it around, 98 bottles of tea on the wall. And then it repeats until there's no bottles of tea on the wall, right? That's the whole idea. And we want to do this over and over again until we have zero bottles on the wall. So part of this is you're thinking, wow, I want to do this and see how there is this number of bottles and it's changing. It's going from 99 to zero. And we could write code to have us do this. Here is potentially output that we could have our code do. Here it starts with 99 bottles, then it goes to 98, then 97, on and on and on until there's zero bottles on the wall. So to first think about this, let's talk about creating pseudocode, which is not real code, but what, you know, we start out thinking, what would it be like? What are we kind of thinking about? Well, we're going to create a variable called bottles, and we're going to set it equal to 99. And then while the bottles are greater, that number of bottles is greater than zero, we're going to sing the little song, sing the little phrase, take one down. Well, take one down means that we want to decrease the number of bottles by one, and then we're going to pass it around. That's, again, something we're printing, displaying to the user, and then we repeat this over and over and over again. So here is code that we could use for this. Again, we have not taught you this, but I wanted you to, you know, kind of see code from the beginning. We're creating a variable called bottles here, creating a variable. And then while the number of bottles is greater than zero, we're going to sing the little how many bottles we have on the wall. We are going to then sing it again without on the wall. We're going to say, take one down, pass it around, and then we decrease the number of bottles. And we know how to do that just by using an expression, bottles equals bottles minus one. Then we print, again, the new number of bottles on the wall, and then it repeats again. And it's going to keep on repeating and repeating and repeating, changing as the number of bottles decreases until at the very end, we can say that the tea is all gone. Here's another motivation that reasons why we want to use loops is it's easy for a user to make mistakes when they type answers. You know, we're going to ask them for something and maybe we want a yes or no answer and they answer something other than Y or N. And should our program just quit, like just exit right then and there, or should we ask it again? We learned in branching that we can use an if. So if it equals y, then we do something. And if it equals n, we do else. If it equals n, we do something. Well, now we want to actually keep on looping, right, until they give us something that we want. Because here's the two different solutions, right? We could either say, you know, this is kind of pretending that we're doing a T order, and we thank them for ordering tea. We want to ask them a question. Do you want cream in your tea? And we are asking for Y or N, and they give us Q, and we don't know what Q means. So we could just have, we could say, hey, invalid choice, and end the program. Or we could tell them it's an invalid choice, ask them to enter it again, and then continue with the rest of the order and making sure that, you know, maybe we send the right message to the person to start making their order. So this is what we want to do now. We can use loops to do this. So we're going to continue this. We're going to ask until they enter valid input. So here's some pseudocode. So we basically want to get input from them. We want to say we want to loop while their input is invalid. We're going to loop. So while it's invalid, while it's not what we want, we're going to ask them to input again. ask them to input again. So thinking about that wire N, here's some more pseudocode that's going to look a little bit more code, that light code. I love doing that where we kind of write out our ideas, our algorithms in pseudocode, and then eventually we get to the point of actually having real Python code. So here I'm saying, well, I know to get user input, I call the input function and I give it a prompt string, and this it's going to be the question that I want to ask them. And then while that user string, whatever that result I get back from the input, doesn't equal Y and it doesn't equal N. Because if I get either of those, I'm good. And I'm only going to be able to get either of them, one or the other. So I want Y or N. So I need to make sure that I don't have, while it doesn't equal Y, and it doesn't equal N, I need to ask, that is invalid, and then I'm going to ask it again. So I can finally get to what I want, which is user string equals input. Do you want cream, Y, or N? Ask the user that. And while the user string doesn't equal Y, and it doesn't equal N, I'm going to go into the loop and ask them again, do you want cream? Okay. So this is the idea of using loops. We actually have two types of loops in Python. We have a while loop and a for loop. And we're going to start with a while loop. And then in the next week, we will cover for loops. And I love to think about fruit loops when I talk about loops, because did you notice that the word fruit in Fruit Loops is spelled with two O's? Because O's, loop, 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 that makes that circle, that looping. So a while loop, we like to start with a while loop because it's similar to an if statement. Branching, right? Where you have an if statement and you have some kind of condition. You're asking, hey, is something true or false? And so a while loop says, as long as that condition, that Boolean expression is true, so it equals true, the code block or the loop body is executed. And once that condition is false, the loop exits and the program continues after the loop. So here is a little bit of pseudocode for a while loop in general. We use this reserved word while, then that condition is going to be some kind of Boolean condition. So something that equates to true or false. We use that colon, and then we say, so inside this condition, inside the while loop, the condition is true. It equals true. We can have as many statements as we want, just like an if. And then to say that we're done with our while loop, we jump back out, we reverse indent, and after the while loop, the condition is false. And what determines this, this code block inside the while loop is indentation. So you must indent those lines that are in the while loop. Any lines that are not indented, that basically stops the while loop. So this allows us to do repeated code. For example, let's do an example where we want the user to enter in three scores. We're going to calculate the average and print it. So with three scores, we could easily just write this code. Total equals zero, get the score from the user, whatever that score is, add it to the total, get another score, add that score to the total, get another score, add that to the score to the total, and then divide the total by three, and then we have the average. So for example, here would be an example, right, of the user enters in three different scores, one, two, three, the average, and then it calculates the average. Okay, so that's okay when we only have three, but then think about 30 or 60 or 100, right? That's a lot of lines that you would be copying and repeating. So that becomes our loop body. Inside that body is that's when we have these repeating code, right? This is way too many. I can't even fit all the lines of code. I just put, say, copy the two lines 27 more times, changing the number, right? you know, changing that enter score number 3, right? That's what we want to do. I also want to say that here I'm using that total equals total plus score. We also learn the shortcut, which is total plus equals score. So those are equivalent. You're welcome to use either of that notation. So now let's do this with the while loop. And actually all of the while loops fits right here. We're going to start with a total. We're going to start with a number. Because how are we going to count this, right? Before we had 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, all the way up to 30, right? You think about, wow, I need a variable to hold that number. So I'm going to create a variable called num equals 1. While num is less than or equal to 30, because that's, I want to average 30 scores. I'm starting at 1, so I have to go less than or equal to 30. I'm going to ask the user to enter in a score. Now, I wanted to customize my prompt string such that it had that number in the prompt string. So to do that, I'm using string concatenation. I'm creating a string variable prompt string, and I'm adding enter score number plus, I want to add my num, but it's, you cannot add a num and a string together. So I'm going to stir it, convert it to a number or convert it to a string, and then add that colon as well. So then I can get enter score number 1, have the user enter it, add that score to the total. And then I also, the important part here is then I need to increase that number such that the next time through, it starts here, it does this code, and then it comes back up to this while loop. It comes back up and checks this again. So it goes through this body, all these lines of code, and then comes back up to the while and then checks this again. And while this condition is true, it keeps on going in there. So it's going to keep on going in there a whole bunch more times. Total of 30 times, actually, so 30, right? And then when your final one, we say like when num equals 30, it says that we get the number, and then we increase our number to 31. And when number is 31, num is not greater than or equal, is not less than or equal to 30. So then it jumps out of the loop. It comes right here. Now we can calculate our average, and then we can print our average. So this, again, I'm giving you the shortcut. This is really the overall structure of a while loop. So I'm changing that pseudocode a little bit because I like to think of a while loop. We first, somewhere before the while loop, we create a new variable. We have to create a new variable. And then we use the reserved word while. We have some kind of condition which will equate to true or false. Okay. Usually it's a Boolean condition. We can use ands and ors and nots. It can actually also just be a variable. It could be a Boolean variable. So we'll show you examples of that as well, but we can do that as well. And then we have that colon, and then we indent. And we indent, and inside that condition, inside the while loop, it only goes inside the while loop if the condition equals true. We have to update that variable that we are using in the condition. Remember, we created a new variable before the condition. We test that variable in the condition. Somewhere in the while loop, we have to update that variable. And we can have as many other statements we want in the while loop as well. But we must update that variable somewhere in that code block that's under the while loop, that's in that while loop body. And then after the while loop, the condition is false. So this becomes that loop right here. Hopefully you can see this kind of circle. We're going to loop, loop, loop until it is done. Okay? This is the core of while loops.